steady me, slow and sweet. We sway, take the lead, and I will follow. Finally ready now to close my eyes and just believe that you won't lead me where you don't go. When my faith gets tired and my hope seems lost, you spin me round and round and remind me of that song, the one you wrote for me. And we dance.
All right, would you thank Sianna again for that? Thank you so much. What a sweetheart. Man, I remember when she was born. Man, Steve Moore, you're as old as dirt. You know that? Hey, I'm so glad you're here for week two of The Shape of You. One of the lines in that song that I love is that little did I know that love had won for me. You say, man, but I'm a guy. I ain't dancing with Jesus. Come on, man. Can I tell you something? In the story of the prodigal son, that's exactly what happened. The father brought that boy into a dance, and he danced with him. You know how long he danced? Till they killed the fatted calf and cooked it until they ate it. So, see, dancing isn't just necessarily what a wonderful, beautiful young girl can do to express the love of God to a song. It's God rejoicing over you, loving you so desperately. The shape of you is what we're talking about. And I hope you never come here expecting just to come and sing some songs and hear a message. My hope is that God himself, by the presence and power of the Holy Spirit, shows up in your individual life. That change happens on the inside of you that comes from knowing and loving God. Don't fight a battle that's already been won for you. That's what that song's about. Stop trying to get something from God that he gave you. Stop trying to earn something that cannot be earned. It will actually destroy your relationship with God, because God himself is shaped for relationships. He's revealed himself, that his very makeup is shaped for relationships, and he designed the shape of you in his relational image. Man is made in the likeness and image of God. God desperately wants a relationship with you. So there are two relational realities I'm going to talk to you about today about God. Here's the first one, that God is obsessed with having a loving relationship with you. He's absolutely obsessed with it. God so desperately wants to have an intimate relationship with man that he made man in his likeness and in his image. So many questions people have about earth and what happens on the earth and why did this happen and why did that happen? So why do people do such horrible, why does God let people do such horrible things? Because God wants a relationship with people. He didn't want robots. Free will is a powerful thing. Free will is a dangerous thing. If you've ever loved anybody in your life, you know how desperately painful the free will of another person can be. God is obsessed with you. Not the better version of you. Not the part of you that you think that God, if he really looked at, would be disgusted with you. He is obsessed with you. Let me read a scripture to you out of Romans that shows the heartbeat of God, the obsession of God to be in an intimate relationship with man. In Romans 8:31, he said, "What shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him freely give us all things?" The enemy of your soul, Jesus referred to him as Satan, an entity. The Bible clearly defines that entity, that he comes, Jesus said, for a distinct purpose, to steal, to kill, and to destroy. The first thing he wants to destroy is the image of God in you. The first thing he wants to pollute and deceive you about is the goodness of God. It's why the primary question that you hear people ask, if God's so good, and then the fill in the blank. And they think they're just being thoughtful. They think they're just a deep thinker. They're not. They're utterly deceived by the liar of all liars who told the same lie from the beginning of man to today in the same way. Has God really said that? Is God really good? And he said in Romans, he said, the God who didn't spare his own son, but delivered him up for you. You see, sin demands judgment, and we are guilty before God. And God is righteous. And that sin between man and God would separate us from God forever in a place in the regions of the damned, in a place Jesus called hell, that ultimately will deliver its dead and go into what Jesus called the lake of fire. So I don't like that. Neither does God. So God came and robed himself in flesh so that the price and the penalty for the sin of man could be paid for and his righteous judgment could be satisfied. But he came himself and poured out his judgment on himself and paid that debt. The scripture said if Satan had known the plan of God, he never would have crucified the Lord of glory. The scripture tells you what men did to Jesus was inspired demonically, but Satan didn't know that when he inspired men to kill Jesus, that he was actually putting a lamb slain from the foundations of the earth on the altar of a cross to pay the debt that no man could ever pay. And righteousness now would be offered as a free gift. God is obsessed with you, not the better version of you. For God so loved the world without him that he gave his son. Not the perfection, not the person that you think. No, the worst human being that has ever lived on the earth, God was obsessed and obsessively in love with them, whether they accepted that love or not. Because the reality of it is this, is that the enemy of your soul desires to do one simple thing for you, to separate you from the goodness of God, so that you can now pay for the judgment of your own sin instead of receive the redemption of a Savior. I'm telling you, God does sing songs over you. They're songs of redemption. That's why the next series, The Problem of God, is so important for you to not just come, but to bring people. People far from God. People that are skeptical. Because we are going to not do some type of debate forum. That's not what this is about. This is getting people into the presence of a God that loves them in dealing with the issues and the lies that they believe about God. When you heard those interviews and the promo of The Problem of God, you could see the utter deception in people about who he is. How about that? What has he ever done for me? Imagine dying on a cross and hearing the one you died for say that. So we're going to be dealing with those areas, those five areas. And remember, when we get to the one on evil, Jimmy Evans will be speaking that weekend. That's going to be a great weekend, the XO Conference. How many of you are coming to the XO Conference? Man, it's going to be incredible, man. I hope you come. And over, 1,100 people or so are already signed up and a part of that wonderful event. Jimmy Evans will be speaking that Saturday and Sunday. Each one of these weekends is a phenomenal opportunity, as every weekend is, for you to bring people that are far from God. And by the way, bring yourself too. Here's the second thing. God desires for us to have a loving relationship with each other. God is desperately wanting human beings to have healthy relationships with one another. But the storm of relational pain is designed by the enemy to isolate us from God and then each other. You see, don't reject the shape of you because your past experiences will drive you into isolation. You see, all of us have relational pain. All of us have things in our past and in our relationships that have brought pain to us. Relational pain is designed by the enemy to drive you toward isolation, to drive you away and to be isolated from God and then isolated from one another. All of us have experienced incredible depths of relational pain. And if you're not careful, instead of realizing the shape of you made in the relational shape and image of God, you'll start to build your walls and your prisons that you'll live in and never live within the purpose of God for your life. Isolation kills. Isolation kills. Let me say that again. Isolation kills. The scripture refers to Satan as a roaring lion seeking about going to see whom he may devour. But the scripture said, you must then resist him steadfast in the faith, meaning you can. Didn't say he devours everybody. He's seeking whom he may devour. Here's what I know about lions. Having lived in Africa, I read a lot about how lions hunt and what they do, and actually watched a lion kill. It's an incredible thing to see. But can I tell you the way lions kill their prey is they look for the isolated one. That's why we tell you that it's critical that to find freedom, you need to be in relationships. Isolation kills. That's why small groups are so important. It puts you in relationships that will help protect you. I don't need protection. Yeah, you really do. When we were in Africa, Michelle and I, then we came back from when we were missionaries, we came back here and started this church 25 and a half years ago. So I've been back three times since. Each time I took one of my kids. The last time I took the youngest, Alexa, and we were in southern Zambia in Livingston. And right across the border into Botswana is Chobe National Game Reserve. It's incredible. It's about the size of the state of Connecticut. It's just, it is Africa as Africa is. And so we went on a one-day safari there, and we're driving on these roads. And the guy driving us told us later he had done this for 10 years. He'd never seen this. And here comes a warthog. What's the one in the Lion King? Timba? Tumba? Sumba? What's the pig in Lion King? Pumbaa, that's it, Pumbaa. Here come Pumbaa. But it's a female Pumbaa. And Pumbaa had little baby Pumbaas somewhere. And Pumbaa got away from everything and everybody trying to take care of those babies and protect them. And out, man, I'm telling you, we're driving and we see a Pumbaa just fly, man, running, screaming, ah! And then, boom, here comes a lioness. One swell, hit one smack, bam, flipped that thing over, went over, put one paw on it, and the rest was brutal. Now, Alexa took a video of it, and I've been wanting to show it to you for years. No, oh my Jesus, don't let him show. I'm not going to show it. My wife won't let me. Neither will the staff, but I still think it's awesome. And I won't even describe it to you because the lion knew that it couldn't get up near the tusks, so it had to kill the animal in a very brutal way. And it was horrific. And we're sitting in this open vehicle. And I mean open. And that lion's like from here to Steve Moore away from me. And I'm thinking, there's more lunch over here than there. And I'm thinking, well, I think it just jump in here. And they're trying to explain to me why that won't happen. And I'm thinking, I don't know that makes a lot of sense to me right now. But that animal was devoured because it was isolated. The enemy of your soul wants to take your relational pain and isolate you. But here's what you have to understand. God's plan for healthy relationships hasn't changed from the beginning. Last week, I showed you where Jesus actually showed you God's plan, God's perfect plan for the family. If you weren't here last week, that's a really important message to hear. Because I hear people say all the time, Jesus never said anything about marriage. Well, you might want to read that book. But he didn't say it the way people think he said it, to condemn. He said it to show people the way that God wanted you to have, the full life you were called to have. But the people that came to Jesus were asking him a question. What I'm about to read to you, people have weaponized against people that have gone through a divorce. And that's not what Jesus is talking about. He's answering a question from religious people who wanted to shape God in their own image. And they basically were asking about divorce. And they said, Jesus, you know, can we divorce a woman for any cause? Because you have no idea how the culture had so devalued women, so much so that divorce was an abusive thing that was done to women. And they said, and Jesus said, well, what makes you think you can do it? I said, Moses gave us a law that permitted us to divorce our wife. He said, you're right, Moses did that. But he did it because of the hardness of your heart. Because you see, to divorce was against God. So, but if your spouse died, you could remarry, so they'd kill her. How many of you know? That's a twisted dude. God, I just killed her so I don't offend you in divorce. So Moses said, no, I had to give you that law because you're out of your mind, crazy, darkened. Your hearts are so brutally hard. And Jesus said, but I'm going to answer your question. But I'm not going to answer it in the way you think I am. More times than I can count, people come to me with this question. Pastor John, is it okay with God if I fill in the blank? Can I do this? And is it okay with God if I do this? Is it okay with God if I, and then they fill in some something that they know isn't okay, but they want permission from me. I ain't God. I don't know if you look lately. He ain't me. But here's the deal. How about this one? Pastor John, I'm moving to Colorado. Smoking weed is legal there. Is God okay if it's legal? Can I smoke some weed in Colorado? I'm telling you, people ask that question. Is it okay with God if I get high? Jesus would have never answered that question, yes or no. He would have done exactly then, today, what he did then. And here's how he answered the question. And let me show you what he said in Mark 10, verse 6. He said, at the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. He said, at the beginning. Let me tell you about God's intent. What he would tell you if you ask him the weed question, beyond the munchies and all that other stuff you deal with, and some brain damage, here's what he would say to you. In the beginning, you didn't need weed to get by in your day. You didn't need to go into a stupor. And yeah, what's up, man? Remember how we all remember Cheech and Chong? Come on, baby. How many of you never heard of Cheech and Chong, not younger generation? Bless your heart. He said in the beginning, man, you didn't need to get stoned. You were so intimate with me, believe me, no weed would have been. You would have said, weed? What do I need weed for? You don't need that. In the beginning, it wouldn't have been that way. Jesus takes you back to the intent of God. That's why the shape of you is so important, and why the enemy is so hell-bent on destroying the image of God in you, the shape of God in you, designed for relationships. At the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. So the image of God is male and female. I have ladies come to me often, well, you know, if God's a male, no, God's not male. God is God. God, his image, we see God, male, the full image of God is male and female. What you see in man, male and female, is the full image of God. You can't know God if you only look at the male side of his creation. Man is made in the image of God, male and female. So that's the image of God, men and women together. He said, and for this reason, because the image of God is male and female, for this reason, a man will leave his father and mother, be united to his wife, the two will become one flesh, though no longer two, but one. Therefore, what God has joined together, let not man separate. Now, people have taken that and weaponized that against divorced people. Jesus was not doing a doctrinal teaching on divorce. He was answering a religious question that was designed to reshape the image of God and justify human behavior that was destructive against the very people who were trying to get God's approval to destroy themselves. And that's the culture we live in today. God's okay with this and God's okay with that, and people have just made God in their image. But here's the reality that you have to see today. You have to see this. God made you for relationships. God made you needy. And he designed those needs to be met primarily by two significant relationships in your life: your home life, your parents, and then your marriage. God made you needy. Well, I'm not needy. I don't have any needs. No, you really do. No, I'm all right by myself. I don't have any. No, I don't need anybody. Yes, you really do. God made you needy. Do you realize there are needs in you that God himself has designed you, the shape of you, that God himself said, I cannot meet for you? Not that he couldn't in the fact that he's God. He's chosen not to. Because when he made man, he said, it's not good that that man is alone. God made everything. And when God recreated and reshaped the earth, he said, it was good, it was good, it was good. Then he made man, he said, it's not good. It's not good for him to be isolated and alone. I'm going to make one to be his opposite part. The first place God designed for these needs to be met, and you could call them intimacy needs, the need to be loved and the need to be approved and affirmed and accepted and supported and have security. These are intimacy needs that were designed in the home to be met by a two-parent environment. Look at our culture today. Don't blame a politician or a political party or a people group anywhere. It is the work of hell to destroy the image of God in man, to destroy a two-parent home environment. Because when the need of a child is not met, then there's a deficit in that child as they go into life. And when you get married, he said, you are to now abandon your father and mother, not dishonor them, but abandon them in the sense that I no longer am seeking my affirmation, my approval, my security, my respect from you as my primary source. I now will cleave to my spouse, and this will be the primary person. You want to solve in-law problems? Stop looking. You understand this? You'll no longer put your parents before your spouse. Don't elbow anybody, please. Because no longer do you need their approval more than your spouse, their affirmation more than your spouse, their support more than your spouse. When you understand these simple principles, it makes things so clear. But you have intimacy needs. You have, and God made you needy, and he designed those needs to be met in two primary places, the parental relationship and the spousal relationship. But here's the deal. Once you have deficits in your life, it makes relationships so difficult. And the enemy of your soul and my soul works to destroy you from birth. So many people in this room today that have heard this message, will hear this online, are hearing it online, have had so much pain in their life when they were kids. It's one of the reasons that judgmental Christians, and forgive me for being blunt, sicken me. When they point at people and say, they make me sick the way, I can't believe they live that way. Like you're better than they are. Like your darkness isn't as dark. Like you would have went to a different hell without a Savior. If there's anything good in me or you, it is a Savior that saved me from my sin. We have no concept. And when you're a pastor, you get behind the curtain, buddy, and it's not a pleasant thing. People usually put the show on for everybody else. When they talk to people like me, the curtain comes down. I've heard stories of things that people have went through in their life as kids that I think, my God, Lord, how are they breathing? And then other Christians, as they give their life to Jesus and grow into freedom, will condemn them and criticize. Well, they make me sick. Like, I would never do such a thing. You have no idea what you would do if you were in that condition. I would suggest that none of us today would eat out of a garbage can. Go ahead and move to Venezuela and see the people that would have said that today are eating out of garbage heaps because there's no food. Because of the wonders of men pretending to be your God. Socialism isn't an economic condition. It is a demonic force of hell to make other men and a system your God. Jesus said it this way. Those in authority in the world system will exercise that authority and dominion over the weak. while they do it, calling you their benefactor or the one doing you good. Do you ever trust human beings? Who are human beings? Come on, man. God made you in His image. He made you in His likeness. And there are needs that you have in these deficits. Boy, I tell you, man, you go into relationships with these deficits, you will destroy them. Listen now, only our relationship with God can meet our God need. That is your relationship with God. No human can do that. And only our relationship with God can heal the brokenness and the deficits of our past and make us whole. Don't look at people on the journey and judge them based on where you came from. You have no idea. I've had people dealing with same-sex attraction who were raped at 9 years old, a man raped by another man. I think that makes me sick. Really? Do you have any awareness of what happens to a 9-year-old boy when that happens to them? And they have to come to church and feel differently before you will help them on their journey? Do you know how sickening that must be to God? I came out of the same prison everyone else came out of. Well, my cell was cleaner. You still in prison? See, if you don't understand the nature of relationships from God's perspective, you will never have these kind of relationships. You'll always be better than or worse than. And both of those are statements of pride. You'll always judge people as better than you or worse than you. And I'm telling you, both are pride. No human being is better than another human being. No, I don't care what they've done or who they know or who they are. Human beings have intrinsic value because God has placed intrinsic value on human beings. Unmet needs in these primary places, I'm talking about in the home, mom and dad or lack of one, or in a marriage. Unmet needs in these primary places will create devastating deficits that produce irreconcilable relational conflicts in our relationships. You can never reconcile these. Most marriages fail before they met because they carry deficits into the relationship. And I want to quickly talk to you about three areas of devastation as we wind this down and go into the presence of God and pray. Three areas where unmet needs in your life and not letting Jesus into these broken places and not letting Him, opening your life to His help in the manner in which He designed to help you. And the first one is your marital life, because your deficits compel you to place unrealistic burdens and unsustainable expectations on your spouse. Let me just break it down very simply. If you're married and you go in with a wound or a deficit, and you think getting married is going to make that get better, the only conclusion you can have over time, particularly since you're marrying a human being that's flawed, is that since that pain didn't go away, they don't love you. And since they can't fix it, they must not love you. And it drives you and your partner into isolation, which is the work of the enemy. All of us have deficits, but when you try to make your spouse responsible to fix what only God Himself can fix, which is our brokenness and our deficits, you will destroy your marital relationship. It's unsustainable. But there is something that marriage is designed to do that makes it amazing. I want you to see the statement just as I have it in my heart. A great relationship is when two people who are on the journey of being made whole individually love each other, understand each other, and cleave to each other throughout the process. Marriage isn't about me being perfect or you being perfect or carrying out scales every day and when you do this and I didn't do that and this isn't fair. This isn't fair. Exactly. Nothing is equitable about love. The love of a marriage, God said, is designed that you cleave to each other as you both are being made whole. What's that mean? As you have to process the nonsense in your spouse's life and they process yours, you don't disappear. You don't isolate yourself from them because you don't like how it affects you. The thing that has built my relationship with my wife for 30 years plus now is not any kind of superficial thing or some, oh, that Jesus just showed up and put magic marriage dust on you. If He did, I haven't found it yet. It's that the deficits in my life In my case, I'm more of a happy, happy. What's happy, happy mean? I ignore things. I don't like pain, so it's not. No, what, can we talk about that? What? That? What? That fire? What fire? The one burning us? No, that's a weenie roast. And then I'm married to someone who feels everything because of her past. Imagine someone that feels everything and someone that feels nothing, and both of them are in extremes, trying to love each other. That's pleasant. You want to know why we love each other so much? Not because we've even gotten close to perfect. It's because we have loved each other through the imperfections while God is doing the work in us. And we're 30 years into it, and boy, he's still got a lot of work to do. So I'm not willing to wait 30 years. You will never know an intimacy and love like someone who doesn't run when you're in trouble. That's what marriage, and that's why marriage is hard work, and that's why you need to be coming to the XO conference. Say amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Secondary are friendships. But very easily and quick on this one. You'll place unrealistic expectations, and you'll overburden the relationship. Here's how it works in friendships. Why don't you blank me? Why don't you call me? Why don't you text me? Why don't you return my text? Why don't you email me? Why won't you have time with me? Why won't you talk to me? Why? You need me. Let's be friends. Because you're trying to make a friend do what only God can do for you. And eventually your friend begins to put a boundary up, and what happens? Now you get isolated further because you tried to make a friend do what only God could do for you. Relationships don't work unless two people are moving toward health. And that's what Jesus was trying to say in the beginning. This, God wants it today, just like it was in the beginning. Lastly, the way you go on your career path. And the younger you are, listen to this, I'm telling you, don't waste your life. Because in your career path, listen, if you are inordinately seeking affirmation and approval externally or from your family of origin, it's going to drive you either into depression, you'll just give up, or into unhealthy, overly aggressive, and unsustainable decisions, or you'll be all over the map. In other words, you're trying to find your affirmation because maybe for whatever reason you didn't get it significantly, or you got an A and they wanted an A+. You got 5 A's and 1 B, and you didn't hear about the 5 A's, you got the B. I told my kids, I never got less. Then I changed it and said, let me tell you something, I never got a B in my life. Hey, listen, man, it wasn't for people like me, what's the top half of the class even worth? Come on, man, you wouldn't. I'm first in my class, not without me. You standing on my shoulders. The minute you live outside of yourself, listening to outside influences, I need this person to think I'm whatever, you'll never find your happiness in other people's heads. That's what Jesus is talking about. A security that will lead you into healthy relationships and decisions. That's the shape of you. Let me pray for you. Father, I thank you today for every person here under the sound of my voice. I thank you that because of your great love, your obsession to have a relationship intimate with us that caused you to send Jesus, that when that relationship with you and understanding the love that you are is established in our hearts, that we can enjoy these now horizontal, life-giving, and healthy relationships with one another. Lord, as we love you because you loved us first, that when we live in that image, we actually can empower people to love where they've been limited in life if we'll love first. Jesus, that's why you said, all men will know you're my disciples by your love one for another. It's not something they earn, Father. It's something we freely give because we freely received it. Now, Father, I ask you in this room right now for every person here under the sound of my voice. There are so many deficits in this room in our lives that came through a variety of means. In our home life, maybe the absence of a parent, the rejection of a parent, the physical abuse of a parent, the mental abuse of a parent or a spouse. And these deficits are so overwhelming that we want to remove ourselves from the shape of you in us relationally. Holy Spirit, in this room, you can only do what the God of creation can do. No human can do what I'm about to ask you. Because if you don't show up in our life and make us whole, we will carry this brokenness, not just in our relationships, but we will give these to our children. And our children will live in the prisons that the enemy built for us. Father, our prayer today for every one of us is that there are no more generational prisons in our life. The prison I live in, my children will never live in. I declare that by faith in Jesus' name. Thank you for an intergenerational church that so longs to see the next generation live in freedom, to know our God, to discover their purpose and make an impact in the earth. I pray for every person here under the sound of my voice, every person, that their inside life is dominating their outside life. Reflexively, they don't even know why they do it. They don't even know why. Holy Spirit, bring light and revelation right now in Jesus' name to people. Words that were spoken today, amplify those, take them, make them so real. The scripture, Jesus, you said you declared that the Holy Spirit, He is the teacher. And He comes to rescue us out of the ditches of life. He comes to intercede, to come alongside us in the ditch and take us out. Lord, I don't pray for marriages like they're some mystical thing. I pray for the people in them. Most broken and desperate marriages in this room are because there are broken and desperate people in those marriages. I pray for the people who have been married and have gone through divorce, and maybe they've tried again and again, and they've given up because this isn't possible. Lord, help us to understand it's not the vehicle of marriage that's broken. It's the way we walk into that God-ordained area of life. Father, I pray that fear is not their leader any longer, that they'll no longer believe the lies that have been shaped in their heart about you and about people and about relationships, that they don't have to be perfect to be loved by you, and they don't have to be perfect to be loved by your people. Lord, we will cleave to one another and not run as we walk through our battles. And I pray for freedom in this place. I pray for freedom. As small groups are going on right now, the people will be honest and open their heart and receive love and care in the middle of their burden, in the middle of their journey, in the middle of the dark, that the light will come. We won't abandon each other. We won't be judgmental of each other, but we will walk in the light as He is in the light, and the blood of Jesus cleanses us from our sin. Holy Spirit, move in this room. We wait in your presence. We love you, Lord. We love you with all of our hearts because you loved us first. Would you stand with me? And because of God's great love for you, I want you to sing this as a declaration of faith to your God, of your love in return to Him. Because of His great love for you, we can love Him back. Let this be a declaration of a cry of love, a song of love to your Father who loves you so desperately. Sing this with our worship team.
Jesus, we love you.
Sing it where you hear it, out of your ear.
Oh, how we love you.
I worship you, Lord.
You are the
time is a prayer.
Oh, Jesus, we love you.
A declaration of your faith.
Oh, how we love you.
Recognizing His love for you first. as an act of faith, right where you're standing, just lift your hands. Not, you don't have to lift them high where you feel like you're lifting weights and they have to fall down. Just hold your hands up where you can leave them there for a little while. As an act of surrender and an act of humility before the God that loves you. And in the presence of God right now, between you and your Father, I want you, and this is what the Spirit of God spoke to my heart. You have to be the one to reject the lie. You have to be the one that says, that's not who I am. I am not the compilation of every horrible thing I've ever done in my life or has happened to me. That's not who I am. I am a child of God. As I say this out of my heart, you affirm this in your own heart as you hold your hands up as an act of surrender and humility, that you are a child of God, that you are born of God, that you are an overcomer because you are born of an overcoming God. You're accepted in the Beloved. You're completed by Christ. You are filled with the Holy Spirit. The same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwells in you, and He quickens your mortal body. He gives and animates your life, your mortal, death-doomed, broken life. His life pours into you. The areas of your life that you think are permanent, they're not. And I declare by faith over them, Father God, that the only thing that defines me, the only thing that defines them is how you see them. Lord, that our hearts and minds would be renewed to the image of our God in us. In the image that's been drug into our heart by a broken world and a devil that hates us, I break the power of those lies. But you have to declare it from your own heart. You know the lies you've been believing. You know what came up in you when certain things were said today. The Holy Spirit brought to your heart. You said, oh my goodness, I see myself right now in the presence of God. Forget about everybody around you. As they sing, Jesus, I love you one more time. You don't sing with them. As they're singing, you just say out loud in your mouth, I refuse to believe that lie about myself, about my spouse, about my kids, about my future, about my mental health, about my body, about my relationship, about my marriage, whatever it is. As they sing this through one more time, yield to God in His presence and you declare your freedom because He loves you. Worship you, Lord. Worship you, Lord. Declare it out of your heart as they sing. Everybody's life in this room. Help every person here to see the seed that has been sown in their life today, that they won't uproot it, that feelings will not uproot it. These words come up in my heart. Listen, these are things by the Spirit of God. Listen, listen. You are not how you feel. Your feelings aren't to be ignored. They're not to be discounted. They're real. Your feelings are not the truth of who you are. Don't believe that lie. You don't deny feelings. You don't pretend they aren't there. They're telling you something. They're telling you a lie that you believe. But don't believe the lie. Your feelings are not who you are. They're not. Your experiences are not who you are, both good and bad. Your identity is in a Savior who rescued your soul. That's who you are. With every head bowed and every eye closed, if you're here and you would say, Pastor, I don't know what would happen to me if I drew my final breath on planet Earth and slipped into an eternity. I don't know where I would go. Please hear my heart. Jesus said there is a heaven to gain and a hell to shun. you will pay for your sins yourself, or you will receive the free payment of a Savior. That's why Jesus was so exclusive when he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except by me. If you believe he is the Son of God, he died on a cross to bear your sins, sin debt, buried and rose from the dead, and offers you now the free gift of eternal life, and you want to receive Christ into your heart, I want to give you the invitation now to invite him in. In the scripture, he said he turns no one away. He'll take you just like you are, and you will leave here, not a cleaned up servant of God that he can't bear or you disgust him, but you will leave here a child of God, washed and clean, celebrated by your Father, and eternal life abiding in you because of the Savior, not your efforts, but his. With every head bowed, every eye closed, if you're here and you'd say, Pastor, please include me in that prayer. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Just simply raise your hand right where you're standing and I'll pray for you right where you're at. I'm not going to embarrass you. We'll pray the prayer right out loud with you where you are. Every head is bowed, every eye is closed. Pastor, please include me in that prayer. I want to make Jesus the Lord of my life. Thank you. God bless you. Thank you, ma'am. God bless you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. Thank you. God bless you. Thank you, sir. You can put your hand back down. Thank you. God bless you. There are many, many hands, some I'm sure I didn't see. You're about to invite a living Savior into your life, and he turns no one away. This is the greatest decision you have ever made in your life. Pray it out loud where you hear it, and the church will pray that prayer out loud and together with you. Pray it where you hear it. Say it out loud. Say, Heavenly Father. Pray it where you hear it. Say, Heavenly Father, I come to you in Jesus' name, and I believe with all my heart that Jesus is the Son of God. He died on a cross to bear my sin debt. I open the door of my heart and the door of my life. And Jesus, I invite you in. I receive you now to be my Savior, Lord, and King. Amen. Amen. Give them a hand, would you? Praise God.